The film that you are about to see was made to show to engineering students who are just beginning their study of the mechanics of fluids as an engineering science. Such a course, to be effective, must include a series of well-planned laboratory experiments. This would be a difficult task for even the largest institutions, if only because of the variety of phenomena that are involved and the complexity of the equipment that would be necessary to demonstrate them on demand. The smaller institutions are even more handicapped in this regard. When it comes to the selection of natural phenomena as examples, the use of films is the only solution for colleges, both large and small. This film and those that are to follow are therefore intended to provide illustrative material that will effectively supplement what is normally given in a good college course. The ancient Greeks' classification of matter into the elements earth, water, air, and ether was surprisingly prophetic of the present-day classification into solid, liquid, gas, and plasma, the latter denoting the electrically charged particles encountered in outer space. If one includes the plastic flow of the solid state, all four classes are seen to have certain fluid properties. Usually, however, only liquids and gases are included in the fluids category. With this restriction, the part that fluid motion plays in one's everyday life is astoundingly broad. Almost every aspect of our work, relaxation, body care, and nourishment involves fluid flow in one way or another. Many of these actions have become so commonplace that we no longer give them even passing thought. Nevertheless, anyone who fully understood the mechanics of each elementary phenomenon that is reproduced in these familiar scenes could truthfully claim to know more about the subject than anybody on earth. Cigarette smoke is a necessity only to some. But the water that we drink and the air that we breathe are vital to life itself. Hence, they are subjects of widespread study, as is the very blood that flows in our veins. Equally important to our existence is the fluid flow involved in the hydrologic cycle of evaporation, precipitation, infiltration, and surface runoff. We take the weather as a matter of course. When it rains, most of us simply let it rain, as it has been doing for billions of years. Some of us, on the other hand, are engaged in its prediction or its recording. For such runoff as this not only provides us with water, transportation, and power, but during these billions of years has helped give the surface of the earth the form that it has. Geologists study the flow of water, sand, and snow, that they may better understand the work that has been done in ages past by rivers, winds, and waves. Meteorologists and oceanographers, of course, are interested in present-day winds and waves, in the Gulf Stream and other currents that exist in the ocean, and in similar prevailing airstreams in the skies. Thanks to aquatic sports, our attention has been drawn to the fact that there is almost more life below the ocean surface than above. The secret of the unbelievably low resistance that many of these natural underwater bodies possess, especially porpoises and dolphins, would be invaluable to designers of ships and planes. At the very least, the dolphin has contributed the principle of this efficient racing kick. This barefooted water skier, on the other hand, has borrowed the principle of free surface planing used in these rather more stable, high-speed boats. Men like Leonardo da Vinci watched birds in flight for many years with only sketches of imaginative flying contraptions to show for it. But in the present century, man has progressed with ever-increasing rapidity from toy gliders to spin-proof family planes, from formation flights like these of the Navy's famed Blue Angels, to intercontinental missiles like the four-stage Scout of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration. With the satellites, aeronautics has now become astronautics, the glamour profession of engineering science. There remain, however, countless other professions dealing with fluid motion, and upon these, as much as upon outer space, our civilization will long continue to depend. River barges must be built, fruit trees must be sprayed, oil, upon which our highly mechanized existence depends, must be sought, pumped, refined, and distributed, as in this small section of the vast complex that is the Humble Oil Company. A great variety of chemicals must be manufactured. All sorts of paper must be made, as in this consolidated mill for fine magazine stock, now seen in slow motion. Drinking water must be purified, and sewage made harmless, before being returned to our streams. And the many metals that our industry and construction require must be smelted, as in this open hearth of United States steel. In order to describe such a variety of flow occurrences, to design vehicles and conduits and machines which in themselves produce fluid motion, and then to predict their efficiency of operation, we must first agree upon a special physical terminology. Fortunately, the same terminology is used in the various phases of mechanics, whether solid or fluid. While a great many different terms are used in this one engineering science, terms like intensity of shear, or momentum, or rate of doing work, and while different units of measure could be devised for each one, actually the number of terms and of units is reducible to only three: length, time, and either mass or force, with the possible addition of temperature, if one wished to include certain thermodynamic phenomena involved in high-speed flow. Any type of fluid motion is thus describable quantitatively in terms of units related to these three.